So today we'll be talking about chapter 18 of the book, which is all about expression. So first of all, I would like to look at the learning objective. So what we'll be covering for today. So first, we are going to understand the idea of the abstract syntax tree, which is a tree-like structure that underlines all R code. Then we are going to look at we are going to understand the data structure that underlie the abstract syntax tree, such as the constants. We look at symbols and also calls, which are collectively known as expression. Then over, we are going to explore the idea behind parsing, the act of converting the linear sequence of character in code into the abstract syntax tree. And we will use the idea to explore some other details of the R grammar. So the others is just about going. We are going to see how we are going to work with a specialized data structure, which like the pair list, the missing, the arguments, and also the expression vectors, and briefly the packages in which we'll be using for this discussion for the chapter 18. We'll be looking at using the R-lang package, also the lobster package is what we'll be making use of. Okay, so first of all, in the introductions, the book, they'll kind of like say that to compute on every on the language, we need to understand its structure because it requires some new vocabularies, some new tools, and some new ways of thinking about R code. They did a little example of an expression whereby they have a variable called y, and in which they are saying x multiplied by 10. They are assigning this variable to a variable called y. But if we do run this line, we are going to get this error message. It's going to return error that a val expression environment, because we are yet to define any value called x. So this is going to return an error. So in order for us to resolve this issue, because we need to be able to capture the intents of the code, so we are going to make use of this expression function that is coming from the R-lang package. So when we pass in the expression, so we just say y, we just say x times 10. So we are assigning this value back to the variable called z. So when we call the variable called z, so it's going to return the actual expression that we are trying to compute here, even without us assigning any value called x. So for us to evaluate this function, so the book kind of explained we need to use the best eval. So when we use the best eval, so we have a variable x where we assign a value of 4 to a variable called x. So when we use base eval, and within the eval, we pass in the expression. Because when I was going through the example in which they did in the book, if I just say eval z, it will not return the actual result. But when I use base eval, then I pass in the expression, which is y, x. So it's going to return 40, because we know 4 multiplied by 10 is going to give us 40. But they also explained that we can have multiple line of expression. So we need to do the computation, we need to get the result back. So in that case, we don't need to use eval again. We just call the eval, then we change to this expression. So we call expression, then we send x, where we are assigning a value of 4 to x. Then we are having x times 10. So when we do run this in our console, we are still going to get the same results, just as in the above chunk that I was explaining. So they also say that expression has to be used. We can also use the expression within a for loop when we are running our loop. Here we have a for I in expression of what we still have our variable here. So here we are simply printing all the elements of I. We need to print all the elements of I. We also print a val of I. So when we execute this, for the first print statement, we assign a value of 4 to I. So when we print a val of I, is going to return 4 back because x, the actual value is 4. So for the first print of I, is going to print x times 10, which is what we are getting here. So when we now say print a val of I, is going to be what, 40, because we have 4 multiply by 10, which is going to return 40. So that is what we have for this section. I don't know if there are any comments before I go into the next section for this first part. Okay, so I believe I can proceed. So for this other section, we'll be looking at the abstract syntax tree and what they explain. They say expression is an abstract that captures the structure of code without evaluating it. So expression can also be called as a AST because the structure of code is hierarchical. So when we look at the example in which they give, they have a function, and this function, it has 3 arguments. So when we look at the tree in which the tree diagram in which I imported, so here is showing that this is a function, and this function has 3. It has 3 arguments because when we did the function, we are going to read it from the left to the right. We are going to omit the verticals. So this, we are going to forget about this. Just read the calls going from the leftward to the right. So when we use the lobster package, so when we use the lobster, the AST function, which stands for the abstract syntax tree, just as we learned in the previous session, in the introduction of this section that traveling took us through. So when we have, this is the function, and this function, it has 3 arguments that we are passing in. So when we run that line, it's going to give us the same, we are going to have the same tree-like structure, which this is the first call that we call, which is a function. So this is going to, it has 3 other arguments that is going into this function. But they also explain in some other cases, we can have more than one call that is going into the function. So in that case, we can have this, which is a function. This function, it also has some other sub function. G is also a function that has 2 arguments, and those arguments are 1 and 2. H, which is also a function, it has 2 arguments, but I is a function, but I has no arguments. So if we look at the tree, this is a function, because we can see this color, which is, this shows that this first call is a function. This is also a function. This is also a function. And this is also a function. So when reading this, the first call that we are going to make, which is F, so the subsequent call is going to be G, and G has 2 arguments, H, it also has 2 arguments, and I has no argument. So this is a tree. Or if we do visualize this using the lobster package, we are also going to get this tree. And this tree, in this case, we are reading it from the top to the bottom. So the top, which is, this is a function, and this is also a function that has 2 arguments, which is 1 and 2. That is going to the function. This is also a function. It has also 2 arguments. And also I is also a function, but it has no argument that is going into it. And they also explain that the depth within the tree can be determined by the nesting of the function call. This also, determines evaluation order as evaluation generally proceed from deepest to shallowest part of the code. So for this section, it's just simply the abstract syntax tree because it's going to help us to visualize our code. Just as we explain in the expression, this just to just visualize the code so that we can see the, we can capture the intents of our code in the visual format. I don't know if there are any comments for this or contribution before we proceed to the next.
No.
Okay. One question actually that I was trying to answer on my own side in the console is like let's say you have a function from a package. Would the abstract syntax tree allow you to see the calls that are made within the function? Or is it only for things that aren't you know that aren't part of a function object?
Like I think there is an example on that, there is a slide on that, but the abstract syntax tree will not allow us to see those subsequent calls. But we can, within the package namespace, we can call the function, then we can use it to do some, just based on how they do explain in the book, we can call function, then we can do computation using those functions from those package. But in terms of you seeing those the abstract syntax tree allowing the subsequent call, I doubt.
Yeah, I was taking actually my own one package that I wrote and looking at a function. It seems like it doesn't kind of dive into the internals of the function from what I can tell.
Yes. Okay, so I think, in this other part is just about infix calls. So they say infix calls are functions in which the function names comes in between the arguments, while the prefix calls are functions, the function names comes before its arguments. So just as they do explain that we have this as our infix call. If you look at in between there, we have an infix, which is the star, which is X times 10. And also here, we also have another infix call, which is the assignment operator. These are also infix, they are also function. So this same code and this same code there is the same thing because this is an infix call. This is also an infix call. So these two code, is the same thing as they are the same thing, and we can also show it visually using the abstract syntax tree. Here, we have our variable call Y. Then the next call is the assignment, which is an infix call. We are assigning this value. Then we are having X, which is another infix call, which is a multiplication. We are multiplying this by 10. But if we do use the lobster package again. We use the lobster package to visualize it. Again, we are going to have Y, which is a variable in which we are trying to create. Then the next thing is our assignment operator. Then after the assignment operator, we have X, which multiply by a value called 10. So this will still give us the same result in which we are having here. So they also say that there is no difference between the ASC and if you generate an expression with prefix calls, I will still print it in an infix form. So this is an example where we are trying to use a prefix call. We are using the rlang. There we are using this expression function. So we have our first infix. We have Y. We have our multiplication symbol. We are now have X. Then we put a comma. And we have 10. So when we do run this, I will just translate it back to an infix call. I think here there are some few exercises that is in the book. So maybe we can just, because of time, because I still have a lot to cover, maybe we can just look at two examples. So yeah, let's go back to, in fixed call. Yeah, so then now the first exercise, they say reconstruct the code represented by the tree below. Here we're having F of G of what H. Here we're having 1 plus 2 plus 3. Here we're having X plus Y times Z. So let me just go to my house studio share. Let me just share my house studio for the exercise. Where is it? Good expression. I think it's this. Okay, so I will just let this, just load this. So this is the first one we have in ASTF nested within G, which also called H. Here we also have using AST 1 plus 2 plus 3. Here we are also having for the first AST, we have in X plus Y multiply by Z, just as I explained. So when we do, when we run this, what is that? Sorry. When we run this, so we get the same tree, just as they explain in the book. So the second one was just about, they're still the same. The second question, they said, draw the following trees by hand, then check your answer with AST. So, but when we use AST, because when we use the abstract syntax tree, because here we're having AST, F nested within G, nested within H, nested within I, and I now has three arguments. So this one we also have, we just need to add AST. The third one we also have add AST. So when we run that, we just get the tree. We just have visually, we can see that actually is a tree, F of G of H of I, then I has three arguments. So this other one is F of G, G has two arguments, H has just one argument, and I also has two arguments. So let me go back to my slide. Okay. I don't know if I can proceed. Or are there any? Hello?
All good on my side.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, this is also about constants, and it says scalar constants are the simplest components of the abstract syntax tree. So we can have scalar constant like 1L, 2.5X. You can also have some atomic vector, but we can test for constants using the outline is syntactic literal, which is a function which we can use in testing for constants. So for example here, in which they explain in the book, we can have this function identical, then we pass in the expression to test to see if those two expressions in which we are trying to test, are they identical or not. So we are having true, we are testing if true is the same thing as true, so it returns true. But if we have here true, then we put here false, then we are trying to see if those two conditions are identical, it's going to return false. So in this other example, we are passing expression is 1 the same thing as 1, it's actually true. So this other example is them saying 2L is 2L, the same thing as this. So the result is true. Is this identical to this? It returns true. I think this. For symbols, symbols are like we having a symbol. We can have something like X, which is a variable in which we create. It can be symbol. We can have this object, which is a data frame. We can also have mean. These are all symbols, but they do explain that in BASEL, the term symbols and names are used interchangeably. We can have is.name is identical to what is.symbol. But in this book, they consistently but this book use symbol consistently because names has many other meanings. So they use symbol because name can have many other meaning in us. So they stick to that, to see the word symbol. And you can create a symbol in two ways, by capturing the reference, an object with expression. So we can have an object with expression. So we just, or turning a string into a symbol, we can use the Erlang, which is this symbol. So we can have an expression, we pass in X, and it's going to return X as the expression. So, but if we want to return a symbol, we can just use symbol, we pass in X, so it's also going to return X as a symbol. So a symbol can be turned back into a string with what we call the as.character function from the BASEL, or we can use a function from the Erlang, which is as_string. That, and as the as_string has the advantage of clearly signaling that you will get a character vector of length 1. Example, we have in as_string, we pass in an expression, we pass in an object called X. So it's going to return a character vector back to us, and this object is of length 1. We can also recognize symbols because it's printed with quotes. We can say STR to check for the structure, tells you it is a symbol, and is.symbol is going to return true. So if we check the structure of an expression of X, it's going to tell us that this is a symbol, that X is actually a symbol. But if we use is.symbol, which is coming from the BASEL, then we pass in the expression of X. So it's going to return true because X is actually a symbol. The symbol type is not vectorized. That is, symbols are always of length 1. If you want multiple symbols, you need to use the Erlang symbol. So that is, if we have multiple symbols in which we don't need to use the symbol, we need to use the Erlang symbol in order for us to get the multiple symbol back as our results. So this other one, because I found this to so many use case when I was going through this other section about the calls. You say a call object represents a captured function call. Call object has a special type of list 90 where the first component specifies the function to call, because here we are seeing an example where we have the lobster apps, then we call the abstract syntax tree. So the first call is always the function. The function is what? Read.table, which is from the BASEL. And within the read.table, these are the arguments that are going into the call. Here we have in imports.csv as a string. Then we specify that row.names should be set to false. So when we now look at the tree in which we have created, it says the first call, read.table, it flagged this all because this is the function that we are using. Then the next call says we should always import a CSV file. Then the last the last argument there says the row dot names should be set to false. But we can use the expression to really capture the intent of the code. So here we're using the expression, then we say read.table, import.csv, row.names false. Then we are assigning this into a new variable called x. So when we now check for the type of that variable, it shows that it's a language. Then if we look at the is.call of x, it's going to be true because x is actually a call. X is actually a call in which we have defined already, because we can say is.call if actually x is a call, so it's going to always return true because x is a call in which we have specified. So in the next section, because we'll still be looking, working with the same call in which we are looking at, we'll see how we can subset using our square brackets. And we can say that calls generally behave like lists. That is, you can use standard subsetting tools. The first element of calls, call object is a function to call, which is usually a symbol. So we can have X, which is our object. So we just get the first element, which is one, which is the first element, is a function, which is the read.table. Then we now say is.symbol to check if actually X is a symbol of one, which is the read.table, which is a function. So when we check that, it returns true. It returns true because this is a symbol. So the remainder of the elements are the arguments, because we can check as.list of x minus one. So we can see the two arguments in which we are passing. We have import.csv. We also have row.names as false. We can also extract individual argument with double square. Either we can use the double square bracket just as they explained, or we can use the dollar sign to assess individual arguments. Because if you say x, we use the double square brackets, so we just pass in two, so it's going to return the first argument, which is import.csv. So when we also say x, then we use the dollar sign to assess the row.names. So it's going to share the row.names is always set to false. But they do explain that we can determine the number of arguments that can go into the call by using the length. Then we call in the object, just subtract one from it. Because I believe subtracting one from it is simply we are removing the first argument because it's always the function. So when we check that, we are going to be left with two because it's only two arguments that is going into the call. I don't know if I am right there because I said we have length, we pass in the object, which is X, then they subtract one. I believe the one in which we are subtracting is actually the first call, which is the function. I believe I am right based on that.
Yeah, you got a confirmation. I think so. But yeah.
Okay.
So you have this X.
Yes.
And so you are subtracting a value from the length of X. So
yes, yes.
Yeah.
So I believe that value I'm subtracting is the first argument, which is a function call. So the next variable argument, that the next argument that is actually the argument that are in the function that we are getting, and in this case, we only have two arguments. So that is what I am getting back, which is two. Okay, so extracting specific argument from calls is challenging because our flexible rows of arguments matching. It could potentially be any location within full name and abbreviated name or with no name. So for them to resolve this, they do recommend we should use rlang call underscore standardize, which standardize all argument to use the full name. So we can have this same rlang call standardize, then we pass in our variable called x. So if we pass in those variable called x, it's going to return this result, which is the read.table, which is our first, which is our function. So it's going to say file. The file is going to be import.csv. Then the row names is being set to false. But they do explain that we can have additional argument where we specify it with the dot, dot, dots is added. In that case, it is not possible to standardize all the argument because calls can be modified in the same way as a list. So we can have X, we can just say dollar sign, which is the header. We can assign, we can overwrite it to true because the default we set earlier is false. We can just overwrite it to true. Then when we call X, we can see that we have actually modified the header. The header is now, the header is now set to true. So this section is mainly focuses on function position. And it says that the first element of call object is the function position. And this contains the function that will be called when the object is actually evaluated, and usually a symbol. So in this case, we'll be making use of our lobster package. We use the abstract syntax tree. So we have a function here called foo. And this foo, it has no arguments. So when we visualize it, we can see that actually it is a function. Foo is a function. But yr allows you to surround the name of the function with quotes. The parser convert it to what symbol. So we can have this same function. We can surround it with quotes. So the parser argument is going to what? Returns the actual function as a symbol, removing the quotes. But in some cases, they do explain that we can have a function in which we want to make use of. That function can come from another R package. So we can still use this same ASC from the lobster package. Here we are going to call the package within our namespace. The function is foo. So we pass in a value called one into this function. So if we visualize this, it's going to give us this. And here it's going to show that this is actually a function that is coming from the package namespace, which is, I think this shows is an infix call coming from the package namespace. This is the package, and also this is the function, and this function has just one argument. So in this other example, is also another example, we are having, let's say we are having an object. We are assess, we want to assess this function from maybe an object that is maybe in our global environment. So we can have the function in the global environment where we call, maybe we have named that function as obj. So we are using a dollar sign to assess the function, and we just pass in our arguments. So if we do visualize this with the lobster, we are still going to get the same outputs, which is going to show that this is a function. This is the name of the function that is being defined maybe in the global environment, which is the name. This is the actual function, and this is the argument, just similar to what we have here in the example. But we can have this as an example where we have a function foo, which has these two arguments, one and also two. But if we use the lobster to visualize it, which shows that this is a function, and these are the arguments that are going into the function. So if we now visualize those three examples with the lobster, like the first example I was explaining, We have a package we are calling. This is a package we are making use of the function that is coming from the namespace. And this is actually the name of the function called for. Like for the second example that I did, I'm having an object, which is a function in which I name obj, maybe it can be in my global environment. I'm assessing that function with a dollar sign. And this is the function name. And the argument that is going into the function is this is the argument. So in the last example, we're having a function here. Here is a function, and this function has two arguments. So it has two arguments. I think that is that in which I have for this section, which is about the function position, which is similar to what Otto was trying to ask about calling function from the package. Can I proceed? Hello?
Good on my side.
Okay, so I think this is about constructing, I think they do explain that you can construct a call object from a component using the erlang call through. The first argument is the name of the function to call either as a string, a symbol, or another call. The remaining argument will be passed to the call. So here we have an example where we have call through. The first argument is main. Then we have an object variable called x, where we are saying expression of x. Then we are having na.rm, which is if there are any missing value. So if you omit it, then we always compute the main, we set it to true. So if we do run this call, it's going to give us this output main x is equals to x, then na.rm equals to two, because here we say x is equals to what? Expression of x, so x will be equals to what? X, so it's going to compute the main. So we can also have call two again. We have expression, which is what base main, we are calling main, which is coming from the base. Then we have x is equals to expression of what x, then na.rm equals to what true. So if we do run that, we are going to have base colon colon main. It shows that this is coming from the base r. Then we have in x is equals to what x, then na.rm equals to true. We can also, they also explain that we can also have some kind of infix calls created in this way, where we are having call two, we are having our assignment operator, we are also having expression of what x, then we are having 10. So when we run this, it's going to convert this to our normal infix call, which is going to be x, in which x, we are assigning a value of 10 to x, which is going to give us this. So I think the next there is exercise. I don't know if we should look at the exercise or we should proceed. I will just push it with the notes. Where is the exercise?
How you prefer to go forward? I don't know. You can, did you do the exercises?
Yes, I think I have a script. I just grabbed those.
Yeah, that might be interesting. That just like grab a couple that you find it very interesting.
Okay, so let's just look at maybe just one or two examples, then I proceed because of time. It's not yet, expression. Yeah. This one is like, I think this is what we just, it said describe the difference between the following call objects, call two main and a. Is it this? I think my junk. What is this? Check this. We have this X. We have this call to median, okay. X n$rm true. Use method is what median. X is between 1 to 10, n$rm true. Okay. So they said a call differed in their first two elements. So let's see. I don't know. I modify. So call two, we are having, I think, median. So our value of X is a value that range, I think, is an integer between 1 and what? I think between 1 and 10. So n$rm equals true. Is that, I think, this one is a bit clear because n$rm, if there is missing value, is going to what? Remove those missing value and always compute the median. And it's showing that we're having a function here. This is a function, and this is what the function is doing. And the use method is always median, 1 to 10. And they said that in the following calls, we remain with different combinations only X, and once only median gets evaluated. So let's see that. Run this median, I think 1 to 10, remove the missing value. It shows that this is a function call. So, and it's also median. So in the last call, either X nor median will be evaluated. So let's see either X or median. I think this will not work. This will not run. Okay. Neither X, median of X, n$rm, because call two, we have an expression of median. We also have an expression of X, n$rm equals true. So in this case, I neither this nor this are evaluated because I neither this or this because we are having two calls. So the first one we said expression of median. The next one we have an expression of X, n$rm true, because median, I think median is a function, and this it will be also another call. We are having two calls, so neither those call will be evaluated. We always say median of X, then n$rm is set to true. So that is that which I got from this, so that I can be able to finish.
That's okay. So we understood the purpose. So basically, it's that you know that. So it does apply in different situation. So.
Okay, this section is about, I think, the parsing and gamma, and they do explain that the process by which a computer language takes a string and constructs an expression is called the parsing, and is governed by a set of rules known as the grammar. So we can use the lobster AST to explore some of the details of the grammar and then show how you can transform back and forth between expression and string. So we can have infix function introduce two sources of order, ambiguity. So the first infix function, what they do explain that we can have 1 + 2 + 3. We can also have it in this form, 1 + 2 × 3, which is also going to give us 7. We can also have 1 + 2 × 3 is still going to give us the same results. So in this, in other words, in which two possible parse trees below does R use it? So I think R is going to make use of this because we can have 1 + 2 × 3. This is what R will make use of because we cannot have 1 × 2 + 3. They do explain that R uses this tree. So, but we can also visualize this with a lobster where we have 1 + 2 × 3. And we are going to have this back because we are going to have 1, which is our first call, plus 2 × 3. So predicting the precedence of other operator is harder. So we can have something like this, this other example, where we have the not x, then percent in percent y. So if we use the lobster to visualize this, so we can have our not and then x, then percent in percent, then what follows is y. And they do explain that has us over 30 infix operators that are divided into what, 18 precedents. So in order for us to view all these infix operator, we can just put our question mark and just type syntax. So when we run this in our R console, we are going to see all the infix operators in which we have in the R. The next is about this associativity, which is very, very important because we can see how, for example, we can have a value of 1 + 2 + 3, which is also equivalent to 1 + 2 + 3, also the same thing as this. But they do explain that in some instance, using this the object of S3 classes to define plus in a non-associative way, just as the ggplot2, just as in ggplot2, because in ggplot, we are building layers, we are drawing layers upon layers. So as we are adding the order in which we are adding those layers, so that is how the plot is being built. So if we have a jump point, just as they explained, plus a jump smooth is not the same thing as we having a jump smooth and a jump point. Our result is going to be different because a jump point plus a jump smooth, that is we have a jump point, then we are now putting the smoothing on top. So our result is going to be different because in ggplot, we have seen that it's going to be what? Non-associative. But in R, most operators are left associative. Just as we have seen here, we are having the lobster package. We are having 1 + 2 + 3. If we do visualize, if we run this visually, we can see that we are having 1 + 2 + 3. Just we are going to see the 3, and it's going to show us that this is a function which is an infix call. There is also another function which is an infix call. So in this other aspect, we'll be looking at passing and depassing. And they said that most of the time, you type code into the console, and R takes care of turning the characters you type into an abstract syntax tree. But occasionally, you have code stored in a string, and you want to pass it yourself. You can do so using the Erlang pass expression. So here we are having an example where we are having x1 and a variable called x1. We are assigning this value where we have y. Assignment operator, we are having x plus 10. So when we call x1, we are going to get our result back. So we can now use the is.call to check if actually x1 is a call and returns false because x1 is not a call. So we can have a new variable called x2. We can use Erlang pass expression. We pass in the same x1, which is we now print our value called x2. So it's going to return this. Then we can now check is.call x2, which returns true because this is a call because it's an expression. So it's going to return true. So we can also pass expression, or pass expression always return a single expression. But if we have multiple expression in which we want to pass, we can use Erlang pass expression. And this can return multiple expressions. So we can have our first expression, which is A. We are assigning a value of 1. Our second expression, we are having A plus 1. We are assigning everything into a variable called X3. So when we now say Erlang pass expression, we pass in our X3, the first expression, which is this, our second expression, which is this. So if we have more than up to 10 expressions, we are going to return all with this single function. Then they do explain that if we find ourselves working with string containing code very frequently, we should consider our process. We can, and they do say we are going to address this in chapter 19, where we'll be discussing about quasi quotations. So they also explain that the inverse of passing is what depassing. So, and if you want to what depass the expression which we have created earlier, we can just say expression. We can use the expression underscore text function to depass it from which is coming from the Erlang. So we are having a variable which we want to create that is Z. Then we're having our expression, which is Y. Then we're having X plus 10. So when we want to depass it, expression underscore text, where we pass in our Z. So it's going to return, return our inputs. It's going to return back the inputs in which we have passed into the function. I think the last part is about pair list. And this one is based on what they explain, because this one, they say pair lists are remnants of R, they are remnants of R pass and have been replaced by lists almost everywhere. The only place in which we are likely to see pair lists in R is when we are working with the functions. When we are working with function argument to a function that are stored in a pair list. So we have an example here of expression where we have a function, we have x, then we have y is equals to what, 10, then we're having x plus y. So when we check for the argument, we are creating a new variable called x, then we're having f, then we want to subset the second item. when we make that subset, we showed this is actually, we are having X, we are also having Y, on the value of Y is what is 10 for this second item, because we are subsetting only for this item, is returning X, is returning Y, and we also returning the value of Y, which is 10. So when we now check for the type of, then we put the arcs, so it's going to show that this is a pair list. But they do explain that whenever we encounter a pair list, we can also treat it as a regular list. Here we are creating a value called P1, and P1 is also a pair list. We have X, we assign a value of 1 to X. We also assign a value of 2 to Y. So we check for the length of P1, it shows we have two items there. So when we say P1 dollar sign X, it shows that X is actually one that we assign to it. When we also check P1 dollar sign Y, it's going to return two. So for the last part is about expression vectors. And it said that an expression vector is just a list of expression. The only difference is that calling a val on an expression evaluate each individual expression. And they are produced, the expression vectors are only produced by two base functions. We have expression and also we have pass. So we have pass. Then within the pass, we have text. We create a character vector. Here we said X, we assign a value of 4 to X, then we call X. When we call X, then here we create expression 2, which is also an expression. We are assigning 4 to value called X, then we also call X. So when we now check for the type of the first expression, it shows that it's an expression. We also check for the type of the second expression. It also shows that we are having an expression. So if we have, it shows we are having an expression with the expression one. So if we call the expression again, we assign the value of four to X. We call the X again. When we check for expression two, it shows that we are having an expression where we have X. We assign this to X, then we call X. And he also said like cause and pair list expression, vector behave, they behave like a list also because we can check for the length of expression one. It shows that we have the length of two. We can make our subsets with our double square brackets. So when we do subsets expression one, because the first item that we have in expression one is four, because the first item which we pass to expression one is actually four. I think that is all that I got. I don't know if there are comments or there are further inputs. I would really appreciate.
No, that's okay. I think it's I need to think about that.
Because the chapter is long. But I thank God, I think I was able to still meet up with the time. I don't know if Otto or Trevlin, you have any inputs or contribution to further expand the chapter.
Maybe just a side comment. I sort of wish our lang functions were named in a better way. So I really appreciated your walkthrough because it helped me better understand some functions I had kind of used to see what they're doing, like a Rlang parse expression. Much clearer now than it was beforehand. Thanks for that.
Okay, thank you very much.
I don't have anything. Thank you.
Okay, welcome.
Great. So I'll see you next week.
Okay, see you next week.
See you next week.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.